sleep. Shakespeare called it nature's soft nurse. It draws us into its embrace, at once familiar and elusive.
Sleep is really one of the last great scientific mysteries. We're really at a revolutionary stage in science where we have some wonderful technologies to help us perhaps for the first time understand the functions of sleep. Sleep seems to be present in every animal organism that we've studied to date.
And the fact that it is so common across all species tells us it must be critically important.
That it must be necessary at the most basic biological levels.
Our need for sleep is regulated by a circadian or daily master clock that causes us to feel more awake during the day and sleepy at night. Humans are the only species that will intentionally fight the urge to sleep, usually to meet the demands of our fast-paced lives.
I can't operate without coffee.
I wish I actually could sleep more, but I basically work a lot. And I know when I don't get enough, I'm really crabby the next day.
But how much does our mood really suffer when we don't slumber? This question keeps some people up at night, like Matt Walker and his students.
So we deprive people of a night of sleep, or we gave them a full night of sleep, and then we placed them inside the MRI scanner, and we showed them increasingly negative and unpleasant emotional images.
The sleep-deprived subject showed wildly exaggerated activity in the amygdala, the brain's emotional center.
Without sleep, it's as though you're all emotional gas pedal and no brake. And we think this may explain why there's such a strong relationship between emotional problems in psychiatric disorders that have sleep problems associated with them.
To grasp the complex functions of sleep, it helps to understand the dynamic journey your sleeping brain takes through the night.
We have rapid eye movement sleep, or REM sleep, the principal stage from which we dream. On the other hand, we have non-rapid eye movement sleep.
Non-REM sleep is subdivided into four stages, from the lighter stages to the deep restorative stages.
These two types of sleep will essentially play out in a battle for brain domination throughout the night. And what that creates is what we call a sleep cycle.
By tracking changes in electrical activity, scientists have found connections between sleep and neurological activities like memory. Walker and his team think they may have discovered the mechanism by which the brain creates lasting memories during sleep.
It's almost as though your learning system is like a USB stick. And during the day, we're acquiring lots of information rapidly. We think that sleep is a time where those files that are lodged in the USB stick in the hippocampus are actually exported out to the hard drive of our brain, which is a structure called the cortex. Those files are now safer in this large storage space of the cortex. But the second benefit is that when we wake up the next day, our USB stick has now been cleared out, so we can start to learn new information anew.
The sleeping brain also filters information as it stores it, allowing us to forget as well as to remember. A lack of sleep also affects our physical health, contributing to weight gain and impairing the immune system. Sleep's vital role in health is pushing scientists to explore some of the many mysteries of the sleeping brain.
Did you dream?
I think so.
At the Stanford Center for Sleep Sciences, Dr. Emmanuel Mignot is hoping to shed light on common sleep problems by examining a rare disorder with a little help from man's best friend. Bear is a narcoleptic dog. When he's excited, he has momentary paralysis, which also occurs in people with narcolepsy, a brain disorder that causes people to suddenly fall asleep.
We found the cause of narcolepsy by studying the genetic form of narcolepsy in dog and by searching the gene for narcolepsy. It was a mutation in the receptor for this chemical called hypocretins. And when we discovered that, we immediately looked in humans if hypocretin was abnormal.
It was abnormal, but the cause was different. In human narcolepsy, the culprit is the body's own immune system. In fighting off a childhood infection, the immune system mistakenly attacks the brain cells that make hypocretin.
And when they are destroyed, you can't stay awake for a long period of time.
A landmark 2013 study from the University of Rochester revealed an important connection between sleep and brain disorders, including Alzheimer's.
What they were doing was studying the brain cells of mice when they were awake and when they were asleep. And what they found was that when the mice were asleep, the cells inside of the brain started to physically shrink in their size. In fact, up to 60% reduction was observed in terms of the mass of these cells.
The sleeping brain is then able to bathe itself in a cleansing solution of cerebrospinal fluid, which flushes away the toxins that build up while we are awake.
If those toxins hang around for too long, not only can they disrupt the activity of our brain cells, but they could also kill our brain cells. One toxic chemical in particular is a protein called beta amyloid. And the reason that protein is important is because we know it may be one of the triggers of Alzheimer's disease. And they found that there were significant reductions, significant removal benefits of that nasty protein by way of sleep.
The buildup of brain toxins takes an even greater toll as we age.
Our sleep starts to deteriorate. By the time we're 50, non-REM sleep has reduced by 50% relative to when we were 18 years old. We now think that it's not that older people simply need less sleep. It's simply that the brain is unable to generate that deep sleep.
For those of us who can't succumb to sleep, are medications a good solution?
There's some evidence that it may actually not be naturalistic sleep that those drugs provide. What we actually don't know right now is whether the true electrical activity that happens during that deep sleep is mimicked and enhanced by those drugs.
In order to achieve the recommended 7.5 to 8 hours of sleep per night, experts suggest sleeping in a quiet, cool room with no bright devices. And most importantly, making sleep a priority.
We treat sleep like a luxury that we can choose or choose not to engage in. And that's a big problem. So I think it's perhaps time that we wake up, excuse the pun, to the importance of sleep.